We have with us Tak Stalwart and Druva Advisor CEO, Mr. Dinesh Kanabar. Dinesh was recently recognized as ITR's Asia Tax Leader of the Year for 2020. We also have with us Mr. Arun Giri, founder of Tax Sutra, India's largest tax portal, and experts from Druva Advisors, Mr. Ajay Roti and Mr. Ritesh Kanodia. So without any further delay, I shall leave the floor to Dinesh to begin today's seminar. Over to you, Dinesh.
Thank you, Arun. If you could like to make a few introductory remarks, please.
Yeah, wouldn't want to come between Dinesh Bhai and all of you. But we were promised a budget like never before. That's what Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, the Union Finance Minister, told everyone almost a fortnight back. You had the stock market, which went into a little bit of not a tailspin, but a downswing over the last week or so in the run-up to the budget. There were worry about a COVID cess, a worry about a wealth tax, worry about inherent tax and whatnot. None of that actually materialized. The stock market euphoria, that we witnessed in the last 4 to 5 hours, it's a frenzy. A 5% uptick on the stock market means it's almost, as someone said, it's a 21-gun salute or a 2100-point salute by the stock markets to the budget. This budget is quite important because if you look at the last few decades, you had at least 4 or 5 budgets which have been on the back of a crisis. It could be a war. It could be the emergency. It could be the assassination of a prime minister. It could be economic crisis like we witnessed in 91 or 97. This one was on the back of a black swan event, COVID-19. It's a COVID-shocked economy, a COVID-ravaged global economy. It needed a massive and a monstrous government boost. And boy, we got one today. A monstrous increase in capex outlay, opening up of insurance sector, the thrust on infrastructure, a new scrappage policy, faceless ITAT, ENCLT, and whatnot. And in many ways, possibly, some would call it, maybe really laying the building blocks to a $5 trillion dream. We have with us FICCI Chairman, Mr. Uday Shankar. Pleasure to be welcoming him to this panel. Before I hand it over to Dinesh Bhai, I request Mr. Uday Shankar to please give his take on Union Budget 2021. Mr. Shankar, all yours.
Thank you, Arun. Thank you for having me here and a warm welcome to everyone.
Uday, you need to unmute.
I'm unmuted. I'm not on mute here. Can you hear me? Hello?
Please go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you very much, Arun, for having me. And thanks for that introduction. Delighted to be here. Druva Tax Sutra webinar. I'm not an expert on tax, as you know, and I said that to Dinesh when he invited me. And he reassured me that I was not expected to on tax matters. So that's very good. I just wanted to give a general perspective on the budget, and then I'll hand over to Dinesh. I'm sure you people are more keen to hear him than me. But two or three things. First of all, this morning when we woke up, we were all hopeful that the finance minister would deliver, and deliver a strong budget. But there was always a fear that the budget will have some bad news for everyone. Each category of entrepreneurs and consumers would have some bad news. But this is an exceptionally bold but exceptionally positive budget, and that's the piece that I take away. That large allocations to infrastructure, both social and physical, very sharp focus on growing the capex investment. Very clear appreciation that healthcare, the infrastructure needs to be ramped up and taken wider and deeper. Setting up a bad bank through ARC and AIF route, basically. Relaxation in FDI and in insurance sector. Setting up of gold exchange. Privatization of 2 public sector banks and completion of all pending privatization projects. And privatization of one insurance company. And yet there has been an eye on fiscal discipline, there has been an eye on deficit management, but not an obsession to bring it down in line with the FRBM. And so this is a very clear budget. It takes into account the large social urgencies. It takes into account the concerns of the people. It ticks the right boxes politically, but it also ticks the right boxes in terms of fiscal management, in terms of economic stimulus to economy in general, consumption, demand generation, and investment. So I think it's a really good budget. In that sense, we could not have asked for more. The finance minister has clearly stated that they value foreign direct investment, and there are a whole bunch of initiatives here to make life easier and send out a clear signal once again to foreign investors that they and their money is welcome. Simplification of many of these tax processes, et cetera, and I'm sure we'll hear more about it. But even from an ordinary consumer's point of view, this is a small step. But I know as somebody who has old parents, I know what a useful initiative it is by the finance minister to say that senior citizens, if their only income is pension, which is what mostly the case is, they don't need to file an income tax return. Small step, but strong signal, very, very welcome. I think the reduction in the number of years to which the old returns could be reopened is again a very, very positive message, because it's, for a lot of us, it's part of life that we keep all our records for many years. But look at an ordinary citizen. You don't keep 6-year-old records of anything. And suddenly you get a notice that you need to present your income tax return that you'd filed 5 years earlier. It's an unnecessary annoyance and pain. So I think there is an element of sensitivity that's clear across many aspects of this budget, that we will not increase your taxes, because we know that you, your business and your life has been set back. We shall take measures to make life easier for you in terms of compliance, and we respect good compliance, and we encourage methods of compliance. So I think by and large, this is a really, really good budget. I think the devil will be always in details. Whether the privatization targets, which are, arguably quite ambitious, whether they'll be met, we'll need to move actively and swiftly on that. Again, the good news is that there is a clear mechanism that there will be an entity that would get created, and it would be the responsibility of that entity to provide oversight and take charge of it. So instead of just languishing between various departments, there would be a clear focus on that. So net, I believe that under the circumstances, given unmistakably only bad news of the last 1 year, the government has come out with a very clear intent that it is determined to put the Indian economy back on the road to growth and road to high growth. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Uday. Those indeed were very, very important points that you made on the directional thrust of the budget. And I think what Uday said is something which I would like to sort of take forward, that the changes which have been proposed by the finance minister today are more directional in nature, but they will go a long, long way in ensuring ease of doing business in Atmanirbhar, whatever you would like to call it. What we have going over the next maybe an hour or so is a deep dive into the provisions of the finance bill. I have my colleagues, Punit Shah, who's going to talk about and analyze the provisions which relate to financial services sector, because many of the provisions relating to international financial center is a very, very welcome, is going to sort of make IFSC really active and achieve its objective. We then have Ajay Roti, who's going to talk about all the direct tax provisions. And again, several of them, as he will analyze in detail. And finally, we have Ritesh Kanodia, who's going to speak about the indirect tax provisions. Let me first begin giving a broad thrust of the provisions relating to direct taxes. And Uday has spoken about the expansionary fiscal stance. He has spoken about the fiscal deficit, etc. So I'm not going into each one of them. But let me make a few important points. We heard the finance minister talk on the floor of the parliament that she is going to insist that there is no withholding tax, for example, on REITs and InvITs. And while Puneet will take us through the actual mechanics of it, it just shows that here is an instrument which has helped garner billions of dollars, and where one important lacuna was that because of withholding taxes, there was a leakage of funds, there was a blockage of funds, which resulted in thereafter asking for refunds or lower rate of tax or whatever else, and we have put it behind us. Or take, for example, they mentioned about 75 years old and pensioners' life being made easy. Similarly, for the first time, we have a provision for dispute resolution, so to say, outside of the normal tax mechanism where you go into years of appeal. And again, while it's just a first step that you're looking at people whose income is less than 50 lakhs, where the variation proposed is less than 10 lakhs, they can go to a commissionerate and sort of put the dispute on the table and get that dispute resolved. Now, that's something that we need. We need an alternate dispute mechanism resolution, because not all of us can afford to go through years and indeed decades of litigation going all the way to a commissioner appeals, tribunal, high court and Supreme Court. A very, very welcome step. And now that we have begun on down this step, I'm sure over a period of time, it will just keep on expanding. Or for example, for the first time, the Supreme Court decision has been overturned, where the Supreme Court held that if income is earned by specified financial investors in specified securities, tax has to be deducted at 20% and not at the rates applicable in the tax treaty. I'm personally aware of number of transactions which we have worked on where only on account of this particular provision, the transaction could not go through because the lender goes and says, if my rate of tax is 5%, 7.5%, whatever else, I do not expect to suffer a TDS of 20% and then after years get a refund. And here is the finance minister hearing the representations, including the representation we strongly made at FICCI, to say that please overturn this and ensure that the withholding is as per tax treaty rate. It also communicates a very big signal that India would like to honor its tax treaty commitments and not ensure anything goes beyond the tax treaty. And finally, a provision of a reduction of limitation. So progressively, we had a two-year limitation by which tax assessment has to be completed, got reduced to 21 months, 18 months, and now a further reduction of 3 months. Very, very welcome. We need finality to matters. Uday again spoke earlier about, and not that it does not apply to domestic investors, but you ask any foreign investor as to what are their key concerns when they make investment into India. And they come back and say, your matters never come to an end. Here we are. We thought we got an assessment order. The assessment order came after intense scrutiny. And lo and behold, we are told that for the next 6 years, the tax office can just revisit everything. Now that 6 years has been reduced to 3, of course, it can go to 10 years for cases of evasion, etc., for which none of us would want to have any sympathy at all. But again, all steps which are very much in the right direction, and I would very much echo the point which Uday made, that this is what a finance minister ought to be communicating at a point of time when the economy is coming to grips with the pandemic. So with those broad remarks, let me hand over to Puneet to talk about the direct tax proposals insofar as they relate to financial services sector.
Thank you, Dinesh. I think you made right points in terms of some of these steps which have been taken by the finance minister, which is in accordance with the overall macro picture and macro direction, which has been given to the economy in the last few years. First, we would look at some of the provisions of the GIFT City, the International Financial Services Center. This is again in accordance with the stated objective to make the GIFT City vibrant and more active. The GIFT City has been in existence for last more than 10 years. However, not several financial institutions have taken advantage of being relocating to GIFT City or the funds being relocating to GIFT City and operating from there. This is mainly because of ambiguity on several tax provisions. And this budget tries to provide certain clarity on some of those provisions, and we'll just look at the few of them. The first being the relocation of funds, a very, very interesting provision. Most of the funds, as we are aware, they are operating from outside of India. It could be either Mauritius, it could be Singapore, or any other tax efficient jurisdiction. What has happened under this provision is that there has been incentive which is given to the funds to relocate to GIFT City in a tax neutral manner. So any capital gains arising out of the relocation of fund from overseas jurisdiction into the GIFT City would be tax exempt for the fund as well as for the shareholders or for the unit holders in those funds. A very, very, very welcome provision. This would certainly encourage the funds to relocate and to look at GIFT City in a much more favorable manner. Also, it has taken care of a provision where the losses would have lapsed if the shareholding is changes more than 51% in the underlying portfolio companies. The provision has been made that losses will not lapse on account of such relocation. Again, a very, very important and welcome provision. If you look at some of the other provisions relating to GIFT City, which has been proposed in this budget, the transfer of the securities, debts, especially debt securities, by an investment division of the offshore banking unit located in GIFT City would not be liable to tax for that particular unit. Now, that unit has to be registered as Category 3 AIF, and the tax on transfer of the debt securities and the F&O transactions would now not be liable to tax in the GIFT City for such investment divisions of offshore banking units. The unit has to commence operations on or before 31st March 2024. A very, very, very positive step in that direction. Similarly, income arising to non-residents from transfer of non-deliverable forward contracts, again, with an offshore banking unit, will not be liable to tax. The third important provision is royalty income of a non-resident from a lease of aircraft to a unit in GIFT City will not be liable to tax again. So it's an encouragement for the domestic units which are located in GIFT City to enter into these transactions and for the non-residents to derive this income in a tax-efficient way. Going to the next provision, the income from transfer of aircraft or aircraft engine leased by the GIFT City unit, again, to a domestic company prior to such transfer, again, shall be eligible for tax holiday. The unit has to commence operations on or before 31st March 2024. Moving on to the next set of provisions relating to ADIA and the sovereign wealth funds and the pension funds and providing incentives to them. These incentives were provided in the last budget, where the tax incentives have been given to various stream of income arising out of transfer of investments into infrastructure sector in India. The sovereign wealth funds as well as pension funds have demanded or have represented for relaxation of some of the restrictive conditions. And I think it was extremely fair that those conditions were relaxed. The government has looked at those conditions and provided necessary relaxations. Again, a step in right direction, very positive development. I'm sure because of these provisions, there would be enhanced flow of the FDI from the sovereign wealth fund as well as the pension funds. So if you look at some of those conditions, the investment in the AIFs covered by the incentives would be covered under tax holiday, and the investment is reduced from 100% to 50%. So a major relaxation in that particular sphere. Then investment in a domestic company, like a holding company, which is set up in India, which makes investment into infrastructure sector up to 75%. Again, the tax exemption would be given to the pension funds and sovereign wealth funds for investing in such a company. Similarly, investment in NBFCs, which is in the business of lending up to 90% to the specified business, which is again infrastructure business, would again be tax exempt for the pension funds and sovereign wealth funds for investing into such a company. Of course, exemption would be prorated in case the investments are less than 100%, which is quite fair. The sovereign wealth funds and pension funds, that is loans and borrowings, for the purpose of making investments, shall not be eligible for the investment. The condition for not being liable to tax is now relaxed. Very, very interesting provision. What has happened in certain countries where the pension funds were not liable to tax, or they were liable to tax, but subsequent exemption has been provided to those pension funds. Now, those set of pension funds are also covered for the relaxation and for the incentives under this provision. And similarly, one of the conditions which was imposed on the sovereign wealth funds was that those funds should not carry on any commercial activity to be eligible for getting this incentive under this particular section. The relaxation has been provided that investment monitoring, including right to appoint directors and executive directors, will not amount to carrying on commercial activity, and they would still be eligible for the incentives under this section. So all in all, I think if India has that intent of inviting huge amount of foreign investment flows from the sovereign wealth funds and pension funds and into the infrastructure sector, then those conditions were needed to be relaxed. And I'm sure that relaxation of these conditions would result into enhanced flow and would encourage these funds to put in additional money into the country. Moving into the other set of provisions impacting the financial services sector, the relaxations are proposed from applicable conditions if eligible fund manager is in IFSC. Very, very interesting condition, very interesting provision. Section 9A of the Income Tax Act currently exempts the fund manager in India from constituting a taxable presence of the overseas fund manager, provided certain conditions are satisfied or certain conditions are complied with. Those conditions are considered to be quite onerous, and very handful of funds have satisfied these conditions as of today. So what is now provided is that if the fund is located in GIFT City, then some of those conditions would be relaxed by the government by way of a separate notification. Again, a very welcome step and encouraging several fund managers to relocate to the GIFT City. The next one, provision relating to FPIs, the income which they derive from securities. Dinesh touched upon it. Because of Supreme Court ruling in case of Pilcom, the law was read down to say that the withholding tax at the rate of 20% would be applicable to income payable to FPIs as well. And the benefit of tax treaty, lower rate, would not be given by the payer at the time of making payment of that income to the FPIs. This was certainly creating huge problem for FPIs because the withholding tax will be at 20%. The tax rate or withholding tax rate under the tax treaties were much lower. Say, for example, in case of Mauritius, it is 5%. In case of Singapore, it is 10%. And some other countries where, again, it is 10%. And therefore, the balance amount would result into refund for these FPIs and would result into blockage of funds. Clearly, this was not intended. And a suitable modification is now proposed in Section 196D. To provide that the treaty rate would be applicable while making payment to FPIs. A very, very welcome step. Coming to REITs and InvITs, again, Dinesh touched upon it. Any dividend payment made to REITs and InvITs were liable to 10% withholding tax. A loophole in the law because the dividend income is not liable to tax in the hands of REITs and InvITs, while the withholding tax resulted into cash leakage for them. And therefore, with this suitable amendment, the cash leakage would now be done away with and would result into a favorable tax regime for REITs and InvITs. I think a very, very positive step in the direction. And lastly, infrastructure debt fund has been added to the eligible issuers of zero coupon bonds. This is, of course, subject to Government of India notifying those zero coupon bonds. Again, quite tax efficient and less expensive way of raising debt funding by some of those eligible issuers. Quite a welcome step. Yeah. For a subsequent direct tax provisions, I would invite my partner Ajay Roddy to take over from here. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Puneet. So I'll spend probably the next 30 minutes or so just taking all of you through the changes that have been proposed on the direct tax side. And what I will begin with is probably one of those changes, which is sort of amongst all the ones announced today, which we can term it as one of the least desirable ones, which is really the changes relating to depreciation on goodwill. You know, most of us would be aware that because of certain judicial pronouncements, including from the Supreme Court, goodwill of business and profession was eligible for depreciation, and there were companies and other taxpayers who've been claiming a depreciation allowance on goodwill. Now, the law is proposed to be amended to make goodwill of business or profession not an asset eligible for depreciation under Section 32. And this is proposed to be done retrospectively from 98. Now, there's a little bit of confusion when you read the memorandum and the clauses together to see what happens on the past year, if they can today go back and deny those, even where assessments are currently underway, litigation is currently underway before the tribunal, CIT appeals, etc. Leaving aside that bit of lack of clarity that is there, going forward from financial year 2021 onwards, goodwill, even if it is purchased for business, is ineligible for a depreciation claim. In those cases where depreciation has already been claimed, then the cost of acquisition of that goodwill for the purpose of computing capital gains when further sale happens at a later point of time is to be taken at cost minus the depreciation that's already been claimed. Like I said, this is possibly one of those changes which is not too desirable, just unsettles some of the positions which has been upheld by the courts, many taxpayers had been claiming. This probably is one key change on the direct tax side that's there. The second one that I would want to cover, again, putting it in the same basket, is a permanent disallowance of late deposit of employees' contribution to PF, etc. Now, again, the law was not very clear on this. There were judicial pronouncements which permitted a deduction or upheld a deduction for those deposits which were late beyond the due date, but before the filing of return of income. Now, the law has been proposed to be made very clear that there will be a permanent disallowance in case of late deposit of the employee's contribution. Moving on to a few other provisions, which largely are around rationalization and some changes, which I will cover, including on procedural and compliance aspect. A big one would be on MAT provisions applicable from assessment year 21-22 onwards. Dividend income is not to be included in book profits while computing MAT for foreign companies. And also, for exclusion of the past year income, which is included in book profit, given the secondary adjustment or APA, now an application is to be made to the assessing officer for recomputing book profits of the past year and tax payable for previous year. The manner is yet to be prescribed. So these are situations where there is an APA concluded with a rollback clause, or even without a rollback clause, where the APA gets concluded after the close of the financial year. And for the past years, you actually raise a supplementary invoice, so the supplementary billing done on account of the AP or secondary adjustment, those amounts would come in and get credited in the income of the current financial year. And the question is whether those would be liable for MAT in the current year. Now the law is proposed to be amended to exclude the past year income which has been included and the recomputation to be done by the assessing officer. There's been an interesting change that's been brought in on capital gains in case of dissolution or reconstitution of a firm, association of persons or body of individuals. The two subsections are sought to be introduced in section 45, which basically make a receipt of a capital asset or any other asset or cash by a partner of any of the specified firm, AOP or BOI, taxable in the hands of the entity on distribution of such capital at the time of dissolution or reconstitution. Now, like I said, the taxability is in the hands of the firm or the AOP or BOI. And the capital asset distribution up to the balance of payment is beyond that becomes taxable. Any excess in respect of in addition to the capital balance becomes taxable. The fair value, market value of the capital asset distributed is deemed to be the full value consideration. And you would also ignore all revaluation on the assets and compute the capital gains. This would be taxable in the hands of the firm, just to reiterate. Another interesting amendment, again, to, so to say, negate a ruling, has been this definition, the proposed amendment to the definition of the term slump sale. The slump sale definition is proposed to be widened to include transfer of undertaking by any means, which would include an exchange, which is where a non-cash consideration is there. Again, most of you would be aware, there were rulings which held that a exchange, a slump exchange, where the consideration is not in cash, would not be a transfer of an undertaking, and therefore would not be a sale of an undertaking, and therefore not liable to tax as slump sale. But now that's been changed. However, there's no specific provision for valuation of that non-cash consideration that's been prescribed, but I'm sure that would be done in the due course. But now slump exchanges will become taxable going forward. The provisions relating to TCS on goods is now proposed to be replaced with a TDS. The buyer is now liable to deduct tax at 0.1% on the same amounts in the same conditions as the TCS. And if no permanent account number is furnished, the TDS is to be deducted at 5% rate. Now, possibly this just replaces the TCS for the reason that a TDS is more closer to the reality in terms of who is to get the credit, because in case of a TDS, the person who's earning the income always gets the credit, unlike TCS, where the buyer would have got the credit. Therefore, replacing it with TDS makes sense. But is there at all a need for a TDS on goods? Is a question that one can ask. But at this point, the TDS would be replacing the TCS, and both would not apply. Therefore, the TDS would apply. They also introduced provisions to propose a higher rate of TDS and TCS in cases of taxpayers who have not furnished tax returns for the preceding two previous years, or non-filers as they are called, or stop filers as well, because if you've stopped filing for 2 years, you would get covered by this. And if the time limit for filing such returns have lapsed and they have not furnished for 2 years, then the higher rate applies. The TCS and TDS rate to be higher of twice the applicable rate or 5%. This is applicable from 1st July 2021. The specified SSEs in whose case this would apply does not include non-residents at this point. Therefore, for those resident taxpayers who have not furnished an income for preceding two previous years, the higher rate would apply. Now, you would need to change your documentation obtaining things from the vendors where TDS would apply to ensure that you get a declaration that they have furnished a return of income for the last 2 years. Otherwise, there's no way for the deductor to verify and get a confirmation that the returns for the preceding two previous year have not been filed, even if the due date for filing such returns have lapsed. There have been a few changes on provisions relating to equalization levy. As one would remember, when equalization levy was introduced, it was applicable on all online sale of goods and online provision of services. And the services definition was quite wide enough to cover all services, including those which possibly could fall under royalty or fees for technical services. The way the provisions were brought in was that the equalization levy would have to be tested first. And if that applied, and if equalization levy was discharged, then there would be an exemption in income tax in the hands of the foreign company for payment of tax. And therefore, where equalization levy applied, there would be no taxability under royalty or fees for technical services. Now, that's been amended to state that the amounts which are taxable as royalty or fees for technical services, the Income Tax Act read with DTA, would not be liable to equalization levy, and therefore taxes would have to be discharged as royalty or fees for technical services. They've also widened the definition of online sale of goods and online provision of services to include even certain acts which are done online, even in case of offline transactions to be covered, which could include acceptance of offers for sale, purchase order placement, and payment of consideration, etc., if any of these are done online. This could have wide ramifications. Transactions which are even offline need to be examined, need to be reviewed to see if any of these aspects actually are concluded online and thereby bringing them under the net of equalization levy. They've also clarified that equalization levy would now be applicable irrespective of whether the e-commerce operator owns the goods or provides or facilitates the service or not. Also, there was a period during which both equalization levy and the tax under income tax were applicable, because the exemption in income tax applied from 1st April 2021. That's been corrected. Now the exemption under income tax would also apply from 1st April 2020. Then there are a host of changes relating to the time limit for conclusion of assessments, due dates for filing of return of income, some of which Dinesh did touch upon and most of which are welcome. In terms of filing of the return of income, the last date for filing belated returns or revised tax returns has been reduced. Earlier, it was end of the relevant assessment year, which means 1 year from the end of the financial year in which you could do. Now that's been brought forward by 3 months, which means 3 months prior to the end of the assessment year, the respective assessment year, the returns have to be furnished if it is belated or for revision of the returns. There was also a small procedural issue on those cases where the firms, which is general partnerships or LLPs, were subject to transfer pricing, in which case the partner still had a due date of income which was not aligned to the transfer pricing due date, which is the returns which had transfer pricing. Now that's been aligned to state that for those who are the partners of firm or LLPs which are subject to transfer pricing, even those partners would have to furnish their return of income only by 30th November of the assessment year, which aligns it with any return which has a transfer pricing element to it. The next changes relate to those reduction of time limits for completion of assessment proceedings. Now the summary assessment, which was to be concluded within end of 1 year from the end of the financial year in which the return is filed, has now been reduced to 9 months. The time limit for issue of a scrutiny notice, which is the notice under 143.2, which initiates and concludes in a proceeding under 143.3, which is a regular assessment, has now been reduced to 6 months from the end of the financial year in which the return is, to 3 months from the end of the financial year in which the return is filed. Therefore, if the return is filed at the end of the financial year, you get only 3 months from then for them to issue the scrutiny notice. Similarly, they have also brought forward the time limit for completion of regular assessments to 9 months from the end of the assessment year. The other change, which is absolutely welcome, which Uday and Dinesh did touch upon, is the time limit for issuing reassessment notices. Now, these were open for 4 or 6 years, depending on whether disclosure was there in the return or not, and much higher for those cases which involved tax evasion. Now, both these have been changed in cases of serious tax evasion cases, where the income exceeds 50 lakhs, it's 10 years. In other cases, it is 3 years. Again, this is an absolute welcome move, because whether it is for companies which were carrying provisions for uncertain tax positions, etc., they always were to evaluate this for the 6 or the 4 year period during which the department could reopen assessments. Now that's been brought down to 3 years, which means there is a certainty beyond the 3 year period the income tax department cannot reopen those assessments. Another important change that's been brought in here: thus far, if the income tax department was to reopen assessments, they only had to a reason to believe that there is an income escaping assessments. There's been enough judicial precedents on this, and the principles laid down by the courts to say that the reasons have to be recorded, have not to be shared with the taxpayer or not. And without getting into all of that, they have brought in a new section which requires an opportunity of a hearing to be provided to the taxpayer before reopening any assessment, and a prior approval of a principal CCIT is required. Therefore, the moment the income tax department decides to reopen for any reason, there's an opportunity of hearing provided. Technically, that could be dropped there if there are sufficient grounds provided to say that there is no reason, there is no income escaping assessment. Assessment in case of search cases shall be governed by the procedures which are applicable for reassessment proceedings if those searches are conducted after 31st March 2021. Time limit for issuing reassessment notices is no longer required. There have also been few changes on the startup thing. Again, both positive. One is the last date for incorporating a startup eligible for claiming exemption has been extended to 31st March 2022 now. There was a capital gains exemption scheme or a regime that was there, where if there was a capital gains from sale of a residential property, you could get an exemption by investing the available sum into an eligible startup. Now that the period to invest and get the capital gain exemption has also been extended right up to 31st March 2022. There's also been a provision that is proposed to provide for protection of losses in case of a strategic divestment by a public sector company, in which case the losses which are eligible for migration or a merger subject to those post disinvestment would still be available. They've also done a few more changes furthering their faceless assessment and faceless appeal to also bring in a provision to prescribe a faceless scheme for appeals before the tribunals. Now, whether this will be challenged subsequently because a tribunal is a court and can appeal be heard without actually a physical or a personal hearing being given with only written submissions needs to be tested. How the scheme will be notified has to be seen, whether it would all be faceless or there would be those cases where it would be permitted, a physical hearing would be permitted, whether it's a virtual hearing, etc., is to be seen. But there is a possibility of the tribunal proceedings also becoming faceless. The advance ruling board has been reconstituted, or rather a new board has been constituted. Income Tax Settlement Commission is proposed to be discontinued, and an interim board has been constituted for settling the pending cases. We'll have to see how these things will work, and we will know as we move along with further notifications and schemes which are brought in. There is also a constitution of a faceless dispute resolution mechanism, again for small taxpayers, which Dinesh did touch upon. We'll have to see if this is successful. Possibly they may extend the scheme or then widen the eligibility criteria for more and more SSEs to get covered. There have been some provisions relating to increasing the monetary threshold, which is applicable for tax audit. This has been increased from 5 crores to 10 crores in specified cases, which the FM did touch upon in her speech. There is no interest that is to be charged on shortfall in payment of advance tax on account of dividend, provided the full tax is paid before 31st March. So, as you would know, there are two possible penal interests that apply for non-payment of advance tax or deferral and not paying the right advance tax in accordance with the installments prescribed. Section 234B, which actually is a interest for deferment of advance tax, which is you don't pay it according to the installments, has been amended to exclude dividend income from the income on which you will compute your advance tax. Therefore, even if there is a dividend income, you're not required to pay advance tax in installments on that, but you will have to pay the full advance tax on that before 31st March of the year, because Section 234B, which applies for non-payment of advance tax, has not been amended. There's also a small provision relating to the safe harbor limit for home buyers, real estate developers on specified properties, which is really on the difference between the guidance value and the capital gains, which was liable to tax. There was a safe harbor of 10% that's been increased to 20% only for those properties which are acquired before 30th June 2021. There's been a proposed clarification for presumptive taxation for profession not applicable to LLPs and companies. There's also a few other small changes relating to retirement benefit account, etc. With this, I'll request my partner Ritesh to take us through the indirect tax proposals. Thank you. Over to you, Ritesh.
Thank you, Ajay. While budget is considered to be a non-event GST perspective, what we could see is certain important changes made in the provisions of the Act. I would quickly take you through some of those. So the first is the amendment to the definition of supply. You would remember that there was this controversy of whether when an association of person or a body of individual provide services to an individual, whether the same is liable to tax under the mutuality concept. The matter was being debated in the Supreme Court in Calcutta Club and Ratchet Club has held that an AOP cannot provide goods or services to its own members based on this entire concept of mutuality. Now to sort of overcome this, a specific provision has been retrospectively inserted in the law to say that activities or transactions by a person other than individual to its members are liable to tax. Consequential changes have been made in under Schedule 2, whereby a similar such entry has been removed. Now with this, the sort of ruling of Supreme Court and in Calcutta Club and Ratchet Club gets sort of overwritten. One of the key amendments that has been made is provision of Section 16. As you would remember that you know, Section 16 provides for conditions of for grant of GST credit. And one of the issues were that whether if a supplier has not filed his returns, can a credit be denied to the recipient? And the argument which was being taken was that there was no substantive provision in the law which provide for matching of credit and therefore reversal of such credits. Now Section 16 specifically provides for this condition to say that a details of invoice or debit note must be furnished by the supplier in his outward return and communicate to the recipient for the recipient to take credit. This effectively means that this entire dispute, which we saw in Arise India, so the Maharashtra, Delhi High Court judgment, which got affirmed by the Supreme Court. The question is whether that still remains a good law now after this amendment. As you would remember that Arise India said that if the invoices are not bogus or fraud, the credit cannot be denied. One of the most welcome news for the industry is that the mandatory requirement of annual audit has been done away with, the GST audit. However, this has got replaced by a self-certification provision. So the reconciliation statement will still have to be submitted. They have to be self-certified by the authorized person in the company. So this, in a way, puts a larger onus on companies to ensure that the tax has been paid correctly and the returns have been filed appropriately. Section 50 is an old controversy. As you would remember, in October 2020, there was an amendment which was already made to this effect prospectively. All the show cause notices which were issued prior to October 2020 were put on a call book. This amendment has now come retrospectively effective July 1, which now says that now interest has to be paid only on the net cash payment and not on the gross cash. So if you have a credit balance and you have paid, your only liability is net of that credit balance, the interest has to be paid only on the cash portion. GSTR 1 versus 3B, we are all aware of these provisions. However, there were no mechanisms to recover tax if you would have declared the turnover in GSTR 1, a tax in GSTR 1 versus a GSTR 3B where you would have declared a lower tax. So primarily a self-assessed tax. Now, this provision creates a recovery mechanism whereby if there is a difference between a GSTR 1 and a GSTR 3B, the recovery proceedings can be initiated. Of course, this is subject to following the due process of law, etc. There are provisions for provisional attachment to protect revenue interest. Now, these provisions were earlier restricted to specified sections. The specified sections pertain to non-filers or URD, unregistered dealer, summary assessment, or show cause notices issued under 73 and 74. So one is with fraud suppression, another is without fraud suppression. Now the provisions have been extended to cover all situations of assessments, inspection, search, seizure, demands, and recovery, which means that assuming there is an initiation of investigation and the commissioner is of the reasonable belief that in order to protect interest of the revenue, he has to attach a property, he can do so. Earlier, the provisions were only for specific situations mentioned above. Now it sort of covers the entire set of proceedings under the GST law. The provisions have also been amended to cover any person who retains the benefit of a transaction covered under specified clauses. So if you would remember, under Section 132, there are certain offenses where arrests have been prescribed. So if you issue an invoice without goods or if you supply goods without invoicing. And this provision was recently amended last year to include a beneficiary of the transaction. So not only the supplier of goods or services, but also a person who benefits after the transaction. Now this provision has been extended. Recovery provisions have also been extended to such person. This is an important change under the IGST law. So if you would remember that there were two options available to exporter of goods or services. So one is to pay IGST and claim a refund of such IGST paid. The second was to supply the goods or services on the basis of an LUT, so without payment of any tax. Provisions have been amended to take away that option, and now it specifically only provide for option of exporting goods or services or without payment of tax. There is an introduction of powers which say that the government can specify class of persons or class of goods or services which may be exported on payment of IGST. So payment of IGST and refund is now subject to the notification which is issued prescribing specific exporters or specific goods or services. It is not applicable universally. The second critical amendment is supply of goods or services to an SEZ. We all know that those are zero rated. However, the provisions were silent around whether that has to be for authorized operations. Now a specific amendment has been made to say that it would be only be entitled to zero rating if it were for authorized operation. Earlier, this sort of used to operate for refunds, not for zero rating. In last year in the budget, there was a rule 96B, which got introduced stating that if for the purposes of claiming refund, you have to receive export proceeds, even for supply of goods within the time limit prescribed by FEMA. However, there were no substantive provisions which were there under the law, which supported this amendment in the rule. This was only a rule change. Now the GST law has been amended to specifically prescribe for this condition. So even with respect to export of goods, you have to receive the consideration in foreign exchange within the time limit prescribed under FEMA, that is 1 year. Otherwise, the refund already granted will have to be given back to the government. So these are certain onerous changes with respect to detention, seizure, release, and confiscation. And what used to happen was that if a truck used to get, there was a detention and there was a seizure, necessarily there used to be a confiscation. And what the authorities used to do was they used to levy a demand of tax as well as penalty. They used to levy a tax and a penalty which needs to be paid. Now what has happened is that the provisions of detention, search, seizure and release have been segregated from the provisions of confiscation. And rather than, and what it says is that the issue with respect to payment of tax is a separate issue vis-a-vis the issue with respect to detention, search and seizure. So these are now separate proceeding under the law. So you might have now two notices which you could receive from the authorities. And it prescribes a penalty of up to 200 times. So earlier this was tax plus 100% penalty. Now it says 200 times the penalty. There is also a time limit which has been introduced, which says that you have to issue, the authorities have to issue notice within 7 days, and an order has to be passed within 7 days from the issue of notice. There is a provision which stipulates that the tax authority may actually sell those goods to recover the penalty within 15 days. Now, interestingly, there is a provision for appeal. Now, earlier there was the dispute of whether in such cases an appeal can be filed and whether I have to go before the High Court. Now the provision specifically says that you can file an appeal under 107, and it provides for a pre-deposit of 25% of penalty before you could file such an appeal, and the balance effectively gets stayed. However, the way the provisions operate, it appears that the effective time limit before which the tax officer can initiate sale of goods is 15 days from the date of order, and therefore is the effective time limit only 15 days. As I mentioned, confiscation are now independent provisions. So in a case of a seizure of goods, you could have levy of tax, so a demand for tax, recoveries for detention, seizure, and separate penalty and file for confiscation, which is 100%. So in a way, you're talking about 300% penalties. And obviously, these are for certain offenses where there is a issue with respect to, violation of law, etc. Yeah, this is a general change which gives off a power to the commissioner to call for any information that he may need. Earlier, this provision was restricted to statistical information. Now, it could extend to any of the provisions of the law. So coming to the custom changes, so the broad theme, as we have seen in a few past years, has been Atmanirbhar and Make in India. So, the changes that we've seen under customs are actually in line with in that the perspective of the government that they want to promote Make in India. So there have been increases in the rates of customs duty. There has also been a statement to say that, the government would review the current existing 400 exemptions in a period of time and sort of systematically withdraw those exemptions wherever they are not required. Clearly, and a step being taken by the government to ensure that if, manufacturing is available in India, then those products are not imported out of India. An agricultural infrastructure and development cess has been levied, but it does not have any impact on the consumer because what has happened is the impact of that cess is sort of neutralized by reduction in the basic custom duty. What this means is that the entire cess is now available to the government, central government, for the purposes of you know, spending for the purposes for which the cess is being levied, else it would have to be sort of shared between the center and the state. Interesting amendment regarding exemption notifications. So today what happens is if an exemption notification is issued, and this is only restricted to conditional, it is valid till it is withdrawn. Now the provision says that it would only be valid for 2 years from the date of issuance. And for the current notification, there has been a sunset clause for 31st March 2023, unless, you know, the notification, exemption notification has been renewed. Job work. So this is again from Make in India perspective, where job work has also been allowed on goods imported under concessional rate of duty. So you could import for the purposes of manufacturing in India on job work basis, and you have to follow the customs import of goods at concessional date of duty rules. The next amendment is also a very positive amendment, which says that you have to, if you have initiated an investigation and inquiry, you will have to issue a show cause notice within 2 years from the date of initiation of such audit, search, seizure, or summons. If the notice is not issued, then sort of the inquiry is deemed to be completed. We have seen instances where the department considerably delays the tax department considerably delays the issue of notice. However, such time limit will not apply to proceedings which have already been initiated before the finance bill receives presidential assent. These are certain procedural changes. The relevant one is the fourth bullet, which says penalty up to 5 times. Now, this is a very interesting amendment. Whether or not I've taken a credit correctly or wrong is an issue under the GST law. So I could have claimed a credit and I could have applied for a refund on the export of such goods. Now, what this provision says is that if you have exported goods by utilizing input tax credit on invoices which are obtained by fraud, collusion, suppression, etc., then the customs also can levy a penalty of 5 times of refund claimed on such exports. And the refund claimed has been, the credit has been defined to mean the credit under the GST law. With this, I come to an end on the indirect tax provisions. Over to you, Ajay. Thank you.
So we've got a few questions, and let me take some of the interesting ones. I think one of the important questions is whether the provisions on higher TDS relating to non-filers applies to employees and deduction on salary. It does not, because the proposed section 206AB says that where taxes to be deducted under provisions of 17B, other than section 192 and 192 capital A, which are the two sections for deduction of tax at source from payment of salaries. Therefore, it does not apply in case of employees, but it applies in all other cases of 194C, J, K, I, etc., which is rent, professional payment, contractors. There are a lot of questions on the goodwill amendment, whether depreciation on goodwill would be available for the years prior to this year, and what happens to years where goodwill has already been claimed in the return of income. Assessments are at different stages. The law is not very clear at this point. It appears that they can go ahead and amend and deny the depreciation on those for the past years. If you see even the provisions relating to how capital gains is to be computed, it does take into account those depreciation which has been allowed in the earlier years. The memorandum does create some more confusion because it does indicate that they can go ahead and deny it for past years. So we'll have to wait and see if there's some clarification on this. But at this point, it does appear like the department could even go and deny the depreciation claim which has been made for the years prior to this. There's also a question on whether the equalization levy would apply on those income which is not taxable as FTS because of the treaty. The way the provisions relating to equalization levy have been amended, they say that only those income which has been not subject to tax or subject to tax under FTS rate together with the DTA are excluded from EL. Therefore, if it is not taxable because of the treaty, my view, the EL applicability could be there. Ritesh, there's a question on availability of input tax credit. It says, you know, given that Section 16 has been amended, stating reflecting of ITC and GSTR 2A as a mandatory condition, can we contend that it's only prospective in nature?
Yes, Ajay, I think it is a very strong argument point, as we have all been contending that the mismatch provisions have never sort of been notified for Section 43A, and therefore the department cannot issue notice or recover tax on the basis of, you know, mismatch between the GSTR 2 and 2A, so 2 never got notified. So it can strongly be argued that this provisions are prospective, and therefore for the past period, no recovery can be made because of mismatch. The only issue is Section 16 also has the condition of non-payment of tax by the supplier. That condition under Section 16, subsection 2 has always been there. And that is a point of dispute which is pending before, which has actually been sort of confirmed by Supreme Court in Arise India, though in the VAT context, to say that key, if the transaction is not a bogus transaction, then the credit cannot be denied. It would be interesting to see how this sort of evolves. But yes, the department can now issue notices for recovery of mismatch tax.
Ritesh, for somebody who's not sort of dealing with GST on a daily basis, this whole thing is confusing. But I'm sure, you know, there's another interesting question here. Let me read that out for you. Section 79 has been amended to include difference between liability as per GSTR 1 and 3B as self-assessment tax. Therefore, can it be contended that where there is a difference between liability as per GSTR 1 and 3B, such difference cannot be subject matter of a notice under Section 74?
See, what Section 79 does is actually to say that once you have reported a liability in GSTR 1, you have sort of already agreed that this is a tax to be paid on a self-assessment basis. So now this recovery, self-assessment tax is subject to the provisions of recovery. It doesn't mean that if there is a short payment or a non-payment of tax, a notice, so you declared GSTR 1, you have short declared GSTR 3B, and let's say you don't go, and this is assumed to be a self-assessment tax, you don't go ahead and pay the tax. It would not mean that the department cannot initiate a notice under Section 74, because that applies to any non-payment, short payment. What it does is, it department can now simply go ahead and recover the amount from you as self-assessed tax. So a notice can still come under Section 74.
There's a question which says whether TDS or TCS on purchase of goods, both will apply because the bill is not very clear, as well as the memorandum. There'll be no situation where both TDS and TCS will apply, because subsection 5 of the new section for TDS does exclude those cases where TCS other than the goods apply. And similarly, 206C1H, which is the TCS section, actually has a provision which says that TCS would apply only where their TDS has not been applicable. So in no situation will both TDS and TCS apply on the same transaction. At this point, sale of goods, it would be TDS which will apply. I think this is the same question somebody else has also come up with, as to how 194Q and 206C1H would actually be read. Ritesh, a question which I also had. Can you please elaborate on the amendments relating to removal of annual GST audit? Is this applicable from financial year 1920, and what does it mean for the taxpayer?
So what it appears is that the provisions would be applicable from 2021. 1920 would not get impacted by this particular amendment. You know, while the GST audit by professionals have been omitted, another change has been in Section 44, which provides for self-certification and filing of reconciliation statement by the taxpayer himself. What I would view this as a larger onus on taxpayer to self, because before self-certifying, they have to be very clear about whether they have paid the taxes correctly or taken the credit rightly. So I would say, while it's a welcome move to remove GST audit by professionals, but internally the company will have to be very clear on, you know, whether it is discharging its tax liabilities and taking credits appropriately. Right.
There have been quite a few questions, 3-4 that I could see when I scroll down on the whole goodwill amendment being retrospective. And let me read this question and try to answer this. Goodwill, the amendment is clearly applicable from AY 21-22. So for past claims, can it be argued that the same is allowable based on Supreme Court ruling of Smith Securities? I think on goodwill, you know, the amendment to take out goodwill on business from the definition of assets in 32, where the explanation has been amended, is from 1998. And therefore 32.1, which is the depreciation allowance itself, technically will not be available thereafter. So While this is a position that one can see, we'll have to see the fine print and see if there is more clarification that will be issued. At this point, I don't think it's a settled position that you can claim for the past years. I think there would be some issues on that.
Ajay, one question that we have from Alok Parikh. Where do you see the digital taxes going on basis these amendments and how they could shape up
when Pillar 1 gets formalized? Your favorite topic, digital taxes.
So I think on digital taxes, I think at least directionally in terms of what each country is stating, everybody is extremely clear to say that whatever unilateral measures are being done are temporary in nature until a consensus is arrived at. And we'll have to see, I can guess as to when that will happen. It also depends on what US does, whether US gets back to the table, what the new administration will do. But most countries are clear. India has also stated it a few times to say that these would only be temporary measures. The way I look at it is until a consensus comes, I don't think any country today is willing to give up its share of revenues on taxing digital transactions. Whatever we are seeing should get reversed once there is a global agreement on how these would be taxed. But until then, I think we will see more of these things, possibly expansion. I think they've gone ahead and probably clarified, probably expanded the definition of online goods even today.
Ajay, I'm going to ask some questions to Dinesh and then come back to you. Dinesh, sure. Ganesh, one question, okay, at least. So this one you have to take, Dinesh. I'm going to roll 3-1. And try to use my journalistic skills. Dinesh, you handled some of the biggest tax litigations India has seen in the last 25 years, be it Vodafone, be it, in some ways involved in litigations over the last 4-5 years, which have gone up to the Supreme Court. Dinesh, when you look at this reopening of assessment, when you look at doing away with the authority of advance ruling or the settlement commission, and then you look at faceless ITAT, the whole litigation landscape, in many ways, the litigation landscape is changing. So how would you look at it? Are we going too soon, too fast? Could we have waited for the faceless assessments and appeals to settle down, see the experience, then go for a faceless ITAT? Are we rushing?
So as you rightly said, you have put too many questions at once, Arun, but let me try and give you a broad brush response. First, I would say is that the change of the litigation landscape is very, very welcome. You can't have 20 years to sort of try and reach the Supreme Court in every single case. By crunching the time within which one is required to do an assessment, one is moving quickly forward, one is finding an alternate dispute resolution mechanism, be it for small taxpayers. I am unhappy about one proposal in this budget, which is really the scrapping of the authority for advance ruling and its substitution by a board of advance ruling comprising of two persons of the level of chief commissioner. I suspect that the board of advance ruling will go down the path of authority for advance rulings under indirect taxes, and I do not know how many people will opt for it. It might just become a pass-through to reach the High Court sooner. So you go ask for a ruling and then go to High Court very quickly, because whatever is ruled by them is not final and binding either on the litigant or on the revenue authorities. Coming to your point on, are we moving too fast? Maybe we are. There is this whole issue of whether the faceless assessment commissioner appeals has settled down or not, and it is yet to settle down, and now we have moved up to tax tribunal. Where again, of course, there is this whole constitutional issue as to whether one is obliged to get a personal hearing or not. But it's a step in the right direction. I think overall, faceless is the way to go. How soon is a matter of debate. But overall, I would welcome that. I would agree with your assessment that the landscape is changing, and I would welcome it very much.
Dinesh, I'll just add one question. In terms of the broad, I asked this question last year as well, and this year again, in terms of the broad tax policy direction, do you think we've done well here this time?
I would think so. If you look at, for the first time, you are looking at those above 75 with pension and other income, not being required to file a return, again, a step in the right direction. The small taxpayers, 50 lakhs returned income, 10 lakh variation, you can go for an alternate dispute resolution, again, a step in the right direction. So I think we are moving all in the right direction. Also, I would say, Arun, that the couple of changes which have been brought about fairly quickly. So the Supreme Court held in the case of PILCOM that specified income from specified securities arising to FIIs has to be, tax has to be withheld at 20%. And because the rate is provided in the act, in that section itself, TT rates will not apply. And that was leading to our transactions not happening. We have seen that personally. Nobody wanted to suffer withholding at 20 and then go for a refund for the actual rate of tax. And the government has made an amendment to come back and say, no, treaty rates will apply. So you are again saying that you are honoring the tax treaty. You are heeding to a pain point and really taking it ahead. And again, International Financial Service Center, again, provisions which are very, very right, very, very appropriate, our response to Mauritius and Singapore of the world.
Ajay, could we, any wrap-up comments, Ajay? We have 10 minutes, but I think we could wrap up, right?
Yes, I think we could.
We could wrap up, Ajay. Final words, Ajay?
I think, overall, good budget, nothing earth-shattering in terms of rate changes. There were questions about, whether there would be a COVID says a higher surcharge for the rich, etc. There's also a lot of talk around the world on taxing unearned, unrecognized income, mark-to-market transaction, capital gains, etc. At this point, there are a lot of discussion about inequality, which has been brought to the fore because of the pandemic, and there was this temptation to tax the super rich, etc. I think in terms of a lot of certainty, stability, there have been no changes, nothing that is reversed in terms of direction of what has been done in the last few years. I think overall, it's great.
On that note, I hand it over to Print, for the final, for the closing remarks, and of course, thanks on behalf of Tax Sutra and Dhruvaya.
Thank you, Arun.
Well, thank you all for attending today's webinar hosted by Dhruva Advisors, International Tax Review, and Tax Sutra. A special thank you to Mr. Dinesh Kanabar and Mr. Uday Shankar for leading the discussion today and for their exclusive insights. A further special thank you to Mr. Arun Giri of Tax Sutra, the expert speakers from Dhruva Advisors, Mr. Ajay Roti, Mr. Ritesh Kanodia, and Mr. Punit Shah, and the Dhruva team for this excellent webinar coordination. As reactions continue to come in about the budget, we continue to provide insights. So please do follow Dhruva Advisors, ITR, and Tax Sutra's websites and social media handles for further reaction today. Thank you all for